It is a wonderful privilege to stand here, and yes, I do remember those times with Hilda and Christian, and I don't remember you were ever, you know, too naughty, but you were very natural teenagers, and I'm very blessed by knowing your parents and your family. And what a blessed day we had when you got baptized. And what a blessed day is going to be when Christian is going to get baptized. And we are looking forward to that very, very much. Building bridges. You know that we are very good at building walls. Us and them. The God we worship does not have stepchildren. People who live on this earth are His children. Now the question is, are we really ready to build bridges towards those people who do not yet worship the true living God, what the children's story was about? As we read the scripture reading, and then thank you very much for reading it, I would like to read this again in two translations. NIV says, while Paul was waiting for them in Athens, he was greatly distressed to see that the city was full of idols. And then the King James Version says, now while Paul waited for them in Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. How would you feel today when you see Salisbury, people living in this city giving themselves to idolatry and not worshipping the living God? Is your spirit stirred in you? Are you angry? Are you mad like the king Nebuchadnezzar? What kind of thoughts, emotions are growing up in you, seeing people not yet following Jesus Christ, our Lord? You know, our message should touch the hearts of people. And through the touching of their hearts and building a bridge between the message of God, you start building a bridge between God's heart and the heart of people. And this is exactly why God called us to be on this earth. There was a professional advertising company in New York City. They decided that they go out and they do an experiment. Some of their experts dressed up like a beggar, and he had a black eyeglasses on his eyes, and he looked exactly like a blind beggar. He had a sign over his neck, I'm blind. And he went out to Central Park in New York City and started begging for money. That day he collected $44.10. He went back, they had a meeting and they asked, how can we do better than this? How can we rethink our message to people and maybe touch their hearts that they would give a little bit more? The next day he went out with another sign, dressed the same, appeared the same, he had the same hat, but the sign, the message was different. It's springtime, the sun is shining, and I cannot see because I am blind. That day he collected $161.65. Why? Because the second message appealed to the people's hearts rather than only to their eyes and only to their minds. And the question is, are we ready to make our message more appealing to people who do not yet follow Christ? I would like to cover very shortly three main elements of the story when Paul, Apostle Paul, arrives to Athens. You probably know that just before his coming to Athens, he almost lost his life in Thessaloniki. He is preaching the gospel of Christ, and people got so mad at him that wanted to kill him. So he escapes from Thessalonica and he goes to Berea, where he finds people who read the Bible every single day, and they wanted to check whether the truth is according to the scriptures. And from then, he's coming down to Athens, and he's still waiting for his comrades. Look at this. Paul is visiting the most famous center of philosophy, religion, arts, and architecture of those times. I like how Paul approaches the whole city. While he's waiting for Timothy and Silas, he goes out and visits the city. And you will see later that this must be true. Paul is not sitting only in his room, and he is not only angry on the Greeks, saying, you know, you stupid people, you do not receive the message what I'm proclaiming, and this is the message of your salvation. Why are you so stupid? You don't see something like that in Apostle Paul. He is going out, and most probably he is going and visiting some of the libraries. He is talking to people at the marketplace. He is mingling with them, and he is meeting Jews and Greeks in the city. He saw people worshipping idols. And what he saw stirred his heart. His spirit was stirred. And you know what? He is not upset. He is rather disturbed. And he is asking the question, how can we move the hearts of people from worshipping idols into worshipping the living God? It's a kind of unrest missionaries feel when they go into a place where people do not yet know Jesus Christ. It is compassion. Compassion towards people who seem to be lost without the Savior Jesus Christ. Now I would like to ask you this very serious question. Do we feel the same type of compassion towards people who live in this city, who live in our place where we live? Do we feel the same compassion towards our neighbors? Have you ever thought that God has placed you there, exactly there where you live now, in order to somehow spread the gospel of Jesus Christ to those people around? When we talk about compassion, what the original word is talking about here, what stirred Paul's heart, we need to go back and we need to find how the Bible describes that kind of compassion, what really moved the heart of Apostle Paul. The first text is coming from 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 26. Let me just relate you the story very quickly. There are two mothers who gave birth in the same night, and both of them were very tired. They fell asleep after giving birth to their child. And one of the mothers was so tired that she leaned over her baby and in her sleep killed her own baby. What a disaster, what a catastrophe to a family. She woke up after midnight and she realized that her baby is dead. In her pain, she uses a scheme. She goes there to the other mother and steals the baby of that mother and puts the dead baby next to her. Now let me ask you mothers a simple question. Can you fool a mother's heart? Can you use schemes that a mother would not recognize her own child? No. The next day when the mother wakes up, she says, this is not my baby. My baby is there. And in order to somehow judge the case, they arrive to King Solomon. And King Solomon is sitting on his throne and he is judging people. And this is such a serious case that the king is paying attention to it. Look at this. And the king, when he hears the story, he says, this is an easy case. Call a soldier with a sword. Take the living baby and cut the living baby in half and give one half to one mother and the other half to the other mother. And you would think, what a cruel decision from a wise king. But in that moment something happens. Look at this. The woman whose son was alive was filled with compassion for her son and said to the king, please, my lord, give her, the other mother, the living baby, don't kill him. And Solomon smiles and says, no. I'm not giving to her, I'm giving it to you, because you are the mother of this child. Because the compassion of your heart just showed through. Can you see this? But the other lady says, neither I nor you shall have him. Cut him in two. In the Hungarian mentality, there is something very similar to this. Some Hungarians say, if my cow died, may the cow of my neighbor die too. That is the mentality of the other lady. But the mother of the living baby says, no, don't kill my baby. I want my baby to live, even if he is going to be raised by another woman. Imagine that kind of compassion in the heart of Apostle Paul. When he sees people in Athens going astray and not following Jesus Christ, the living Lord, there is another text which is very close to that compassion, what the Bible talks when Paul arrives to Athens. And that is in Song of Solomon, chapter 5, verse 4. It says, my lover thrust his hand through the latch opening. My heart began to pound for him. This is a lady, a fiancée, saying that when my lover is coming, my heart starts pumping. I feel for him. This is exactly something what filled up Apostle Paul's heart for the Athenians, saying, I love these people. And the third one comes from Luke chapter 15, verse 20. And this is coming from the parable of the lost sons. So he got up and went to his father. Talks about the prodigal son. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him and kissed him. Imagine the scene of it. This father, according to the original text, every single day went up on a certain hill of his property and looked and looked and looked again. Until one day he saw his own son. And this son is coming home. And he says, I need to do something about him. According to the laws of the Old Testament, this son could have been killed by the villagers because he was so disrespectful to his father. But his father loves him so much that he doesn't want anyone else to notice his son homecoming first. He doesn't want his son to be killed. He wants his son to come home. And he is running because he is saving his son's life and he is running to show him compassion, love, grace and acceptance back into the family. You know, I've been to Middle East so many times, especially I noticed in Pakistan, The older you get, the slower and with more dignity you walk. There is nothing which would make you run if you are a dignified man in the Middle East. So when in the Middle East, the head of the house started running, that was a state of emergency. Everybody knew that something good goes really bad now, or something significant happened. So when the father runs towards the son, the whole household runs with him. And he embraces his son, his prodigal son. He kisses him and he receives him back into the family. God does not have stepchildren. God has put us in this place to embrace those prodigals who are still running away from God and maybe worshipping all sorts of idols in their lives. Now for that reason we need to have that kind of a compassion. I like what Ellen White says in the book of Education. She says, in order that our character would reach fulfillment, we would need to be drawn out of ourselves and be intensely interested in the salvation of others. Wow! Have you ever experienced this? We have just studied for one quarter the book of Revelation about the beasts, about all sorts of last day events. Did that stir our hearts for people who do not yet follow Jesus Christ? Did that stir our hearts for the Catholics, for the Anglicans, for the Muslims? Or did it make us feeling superior to them? Did it fill our heart with a spiritual arrogance towards other people saying, guys, you worship on Sunday, you are less than Christians. You cannot ever come to that level where I am at the moment. Let me tell you, if that self-importance and spiritual arrogance has ever grew in our hearts, that is more the sign of the mark of the beast than 666 or Sunday in history. And the only seal of God would be the character traits of God filled with compassion to other people, showing His grace, His love, and calling people back into the family of God. And that's more a seal than the Sabbath day when we worship the living God. Paul's heart, he saw a city where the faith in the Creator God was missing totally. The streets were filled with statues of gods and goddesses. Everyone worshipped their own god. Every single family had a god or a goddess to worship. Pausanias said, and he was a historian, that only in Athens there were more idols than in the whole country of Greece. Imagine this. And wherever Paul turns, he bumps into idols, statues, people worshipped. He meets the Jews in the synagogue and the Greeks in the marketplace. And he's proclaiming gently the existence of a Savior called Jesus Christ. Now, do we believe that we have a message which builds bridges between the heart of God and the heart of people? 18th century British philosopher David Hume, on the right-hand side of the screen. He ridiculed Christians. He did not believe in historical Christianity and its values. And he used every single opportunity to make fun of Christians. One day, he saw one of his friends running on the streets of London. And he just called out to the other side of the street, hey, my friend, where are you running that fast? And the friend called back and said, you know, George Whitfield is in the town and he is going to preach this afternoon. And he ran to listen to the sermon of Whitfield. And David Hume, the philosopher, cried out to him, my friend, but you don't believe in that nonsense this man is preaching, do you? And the friend, still running, called back and said, David, not yet, but he, the preacher, believes. Can we be the representatives of God in our city, in our place, where people who do not yet believe in God, seeing us, would think that, there must be something in the relationship with their God, because it works, it functions. There are four famous schools in Athens: Plato's Academy, Aristotle's Lyceum, Zeno's Court, and Epicurus' Garden. By the time of Paul, only the two school firms flourished, the Stoics and the Epicureans. And why is this important today? Look at this. The Stoics, they believed in fate. They had a pantheistic life philosophy that in everything, in the grass, in the animals, in everything, there is the Spirit of God. Self-righteousness was important to them. Their aim was to discuss the issues of life and the laws of nature. The universal order of nature was the most important to them. They were the environmentalists of those times. Do we have this kind of people today? And then there were the Epicureans. They believed that the gods are not interested in human lives. They are remote there, and there is no connection between God and between us. Do you have those kind of people in Salisbury today? The reason for existence is pleasure. Have fun, enjoy life, and that's it. Pleasure is the best good of life. They have an anti-God philosophy of life. The individual is the most important. If you have an iPhone, an iPad, why is the name of these gadgets start with I? What do you think? It appeals to us. I want it. I am the most important. That kind of philosophy is still present today. Look at the positive approach the bridge-building Apostle Paul is using. He demonstrates on Marsh Hill how to be positive in a negative way. Do you see what is happening in the city today? Your city has been in the news for quite a while because of the poisoning. And I was wondering, you know, that 20 years ago when I visited Salisbury for the first time in my life, there were no Adventists in this city at all. And I was wondering, you know, about these poison. If poison can get into news so fast, how about doing something good for people in this city? Maybe that can get into the news as well, as fast, as good, as the poisoning. Is your heart filled with compassion for these people living in this city? Are you anti-Russian now because of the poisoning happened here? We know how to build walls. I can take, you know, kind of a swipe in history saying Berlin's Wall was a bad sign of communism. I've been in Israel so many times and I saw a wall built, a concrete wall between the Palestinian and Israeli territories. Cyprus, there is a wall between North and South Cyprus. South part belongs to the European Union, and the north part belongs to Turkey. A war between South and North Korea. A war between the capital and countryside. And with Brexit, a wall is being built between UK and the EU. Of course, the desire is to build it with holes, which would benefit either one or both sides. We are good in building walls, but are we that good in building bridges? Look at Paul's approach. Paul is searching until he finds something to commend in Athens. And I need to stop here and I need to say, what a wonderful approach. That you find something commanding in certain people's behavior. He is not taking character lessons to kick all the statues of the idols down from the balconies of Athenians, saying, that's wrong. How many times I have seen my brothers and sisters, Seventh-day Adventists, being angry on people who worshipped or bowed down before statues or idols or pictures. But have you ever realized that in the medieval ages, where people were totally illiterate, when the mass, when the worship service was in Latin and people did not understand one single word of that, placing some of the statues and some of the nice paintings in the church was the PowerPoint of the medieval ages. People at least could see something of God, something of the gospel. Of course, if those pictures later on, because of a false theology, became objects of worship, that was totally wrong. But imagine Apostle Paul going into the temple on Mars Hill. And he knows one thing. Antagonism will not win anyone to Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, antagonism within the church will not win our young people to Jesus Christ. By the way, Jesus said, by this people would know you are my disciples, if you love one another. If you have that kind of compassion, that I want those kids sitting in the back row to follow Christ. I am intensely interested in your salvation. Are you intensely interested in the salvation of people around? Look at what Paul says to Timothy later on. Timothy, guard what has been entrusted to your care. Turn away from godless chatter and the opposing ideas of what is falsely called knowledge. Don't engage yourself in stupid fight. That is what Apostle Paul says to Timothy. Then they took him, Paul, and brought him to a meeting of the Areopagus, where they said to him, may we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting. You are bringing some strange ideas to our ears, and we want to know what they mean. Areopagus is a wonderful and a beautiful, huge stone on the marsh hill. It's like a big pulpit. According to Ellen White, when Socrates came up with some new ideas, the Athenians brought him to Areopagus and said, present your teaching, present your idea. And when he was not able to convincingly present it, they killed him on the spot. So, brothers and sisters, let me tell you that Apostle Paul is not stepping up on Areopagus only to have fun, to have a nice sermon. No, he is preaching for his own life. If he is not presenting something which can be meaningful to the Greeks, he would be killed on the spot. Now we are approaching those times when whatever we preach would be a matter of life or death in our own lives. all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there spend their time doing nothing but talking about and listening to the latest ideas. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus and said, "Men of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious." What? Apostle Paul, is he lying or is he telling the truth? Because his heart was filled with compassion for people and he was intensely interested for their salvation. He says, "I see you religious. I see you that you are my brothers and sisters because God has created you with this yearning for worship. For as I walked around and looked carefully at your object of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, 'To an unknown God.' Now what you worship as something unknown, I'm going to proclaim to you." What a fantastic way of introducing something new. He found in their temple one altar which says, "To an unknown God." And Apostle Paul says, "I'm using that as an open door, as an avenue to proclaim the message about Jesus Christ." Two lessons to learn here. The first lesson is God can bless something which he does not agree with. He's blessing bad and good people. And without his blessing, we would not exist. And we need to bear that in mind. Again, God does not have statue. The second big lesson is, repeating an old truth is not necessarily the sign of faithfulness to God. Oh, 40 years ago I heard an evangelist using that kind of argument, and I'm repeating that over and over and over again. And I think that it's going to bring the same results. No way. Adventism is known as a rethinking movement. If we are not able to rethink why we are here, we are becoming a museum and people are not going to pay attention to the message of Jesus Christ. What would we say to a person who follows New Age? Would we say, "I admire your spirituality"? Or would we say, "Ah, that's wrong, you know, that's from Satan. You never ever be involved in that kind of thing." What would you say to a philosopher of the 21st century? "I like your search for the truth." Rather than saying, "Ah, that's stupid philosophy. You rather read the Bible and then follow Jesus Christ." Antagonism will not win anyone to Jesus Christ. Very fine. What would you say to a perfectionist? Or to this last generation theology? "I like your quest for holiness." What would you say to a Muslim? "I admire your obedience." What would you say to a Jehovah Witness? "I like your zeal about your witnessing." People of Athens, you want to worship a God you don't even know. That is what Paul says. You don't want that God to feel left out. And I'm here to tell you that God, the unknown, exists. And he is the only living God. A couple of years ago, some young people came into my office and said, "Why don't we do something for people in Britain, people in London, people in big cities?" And I said, what can we do? And they said, "We have done a research and people in London feel that they are slaves. They are working themselves to death. And we have a wonderful message of rest. Can we do something for them?" I said, "What do you mean? Can we go to IKEA and buy a sofa for £299? And we would take that sofa out in the middle of London and we would invite people to sit and rest on a sofa and we would proclaim the message of the Sabbath to them in a new way?" And I said, "What a crazy idea." But would you risk 299 pounds for this? And we risked 299 pounds, and also we asked for permission to place the sofa in the middle of London. And I have never seen something that in my own life. These creative young people, they had a sign, and on the sign it was written, "Tired, have a seat." We took out some cameras and had interviews with people, and you would not believe your ears. As people were queued up in the middle of London, I have seen, and I have counted one time, 61 persons queuing up in order to sit on our Sabbath sofa. And in the interview, this is how it goes. "Are you tired?" "Yes, I am." "Why are you tired?" "Because I'm working like mad from morning till evening, and I am just falling into my bed, and the next day I'm starting again." "But sir or madam, you are not a machine." "I know I'm not a machine, but I am running and working like a machine." What would you say if you had 24 hours every single week for rest and keeping up with your relationships? "Oh, that would be heaven. That would be fantastic." And the answer was, "You haven't. It's called the Sabbath." One guy said, "How many kilos of Sabbath do I need in order to have rest?" I said, "No, it's not about kilos. It's about time. 24 hours every single week. It's called the Sabbath. And you can have rest. And you can keep up with your relationship with God, with your fellow human beings, and with the created nature." "Wow, but I can't do this." "Really? Do you know the Jews who are running the banks in England? They actually keep this day. Are they the beggars around the corner? They're wealthy people, and they can afford the 24 hours. Yeah, but that's their culture." And you say, "No, it's not only their culture. There are more than 24 million people on this earth who are doing it. And I'm one of them. I'm a Seventh-day Adventist." "Really?" "Every single Sabbath, it's Sabbath." And they said, "I like that." "Oh, you like that? Then go to our Facebook page and like it." 3 weeks' time, we collected 44,000 likes for the Sabbath so far. Why? Because suddenly, the message built a bridge between the need and heart of people and the heart of God. And lastly, speaking people's language is more than just using their words. You can feel I'm not English, and my accent is going to stay until I die. And I can say a couple of words in English. But my biggest question is, do I speak the language of people who live in this country? And this language should be the language of their heart. Paul is a good observer. But, you know, there is a catastrophe when those who have questions meet those who have answers. Let me ask you a short question. What do you think Seventh-day Adventists fall in which category? Those who have answers or those who have questions? Oh yeah, we are the ones who have answers. And we are stupid enough to tell people the answers even before they ask the question. And we do not realize how much harm we do by just forcing our answers down their neck. Apostle Paul did not do this at all. Paul speaks like one of the citizens of Athens. You are outstanding thinkers. You found out that God is greater than a building. Not many actually found this out. And I like how Paul is approaching. And he says, okay, give me 10 minutes to talk to you about this God. Look at this. Paul's message is all about this God, the living, but the unknown God to the Greeks. God created everything. I worship the Creator God. God who made the world and everything in it. God is sovereign, the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by hands, and he is not served by human hands, as if he needed anything. God does not depend on us. We depend on him. God is the life giver. He himself gives all men life and breath and everything else. Just imagine, the Greek philosophers are listening and no one wants to kill Paul on Areopagus. Because they say, wow, we have never ever heard about a God like that. God has a plan. There is a heavenly strategy with God. He made every nation of men that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he determined the times set for them and the exact places where they should live. God did this so that men would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him. Can you see how Paul is coming to the main message, saying, guys, now you have recognized God, make one more step and have a relationship with him. God is not far. He is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. That's a quotation from a Greek poet. As some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. God is more than a philosophical thought. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by man's design and skill. No. God is more than you ever imagine. Wow. And the philosophers say, go on. We want to listen. We don't care. God is merciful. In those times, people didn't know what mercy or grace means. And Paul introduces this, saying he overlooks the ignorance of the past and initiates change. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent. Be honest, people of Athens, and recognize you have done wrong. And come to this God who is eager to receive you into the family. God will judge the world through the resurrected one. By the way, do you see that Paul is not using Hebrew scripture at all? Why? Because if he quoted Hebrew scriptures to Greeks, they would reject the whole immediately. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to all men by raising him from the dead. Spot on. Preaching Jesus, the crucified and resurrected Messiah. What is Paul's method? Did not quote the Bible one single time. The Hebrew scriptures did not have authority in Athens. He quoted two well-known sources to them. Speaking their language then, it's much more than just using their words. Paul did not mention the word sin at all. In the same time, people felt that, I've done wrong. I need to repent. God overlooks ignorance, idolatry, and Paul talks about repentance, coming to God. Paul spoke their language, and I believe that he went out into their libraries, studied there, and then brought these quotations. Epimenides, he says, "For in him we live and move and have our being." It's only one God who created life. And Aratus from Soli, Cilicia, Paul is quoting him as well, saying, "For we are also his offspring." If Paul would come to Salisbury, how would he preach here? Would he say, "God is near to you"? He would like to draw even nearer to you. Paul speaks about the second coming, the judgment, the resurrection, by not using theological expressions. He's not showing up saying, "Hey, I have a PhD from Jerusalem." No. His message is understood. Look at this. What is the result? When they heard about the resurrection of the dead, some of them sneered, but others said, "We want to hear you again on this subject." What? When he preaches Jesus, the resurrected, people respond, "We want to hear more about this." Ellen White says in the Acts of Apostles, "The wisest of his hearers were astonished as they listened to his reasoning." A few men became followers of Paul and believed. Among them was Dionysius, a member of the Areopagus, also a woman named Damaris, and a number of others. When I was a kid, I learned so many, and I heard so many sermons saying that Paul was not successful in Athens, but he was successful in Corinth. He was not successful in Athens because he used philosophy, but he was successful in Corinth because he just used plain language to preach the resurrected Christ. Can we revisit this just a little bit? Look at this. 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. "When I came to you, brothers, I did not come with eloquence or superior wisdom as I proclaimed to you the testimony about God. For I resolved to know nothing while I was with you except Jesus Christ and him crucified." What happened in Athens? In Athens, basically, what we have just read about Dionysius. Dionysius was the head of the high court in Athens. What would you think? If someone of you would preach in London and you would say, "By the way, the evangelistic series was not that successful. A lady called Theresa May accepted Jesus Christ and she got baptized." What would you think about that? If the Prime Minister of Britain would get baptized? And maybe she would be among the few who followed Jesus Christ. But actually, Paul establishes the first Christian community through those people who got baptized after the Areopagus. Are we building walls or bridges? Two brothers lived together, neighboring properties. And one day they had a fight. And the fight went so wrong that they told each other that, "I don't want to see you in my life anymore." And the younger brother got so upset on the older brother that he used all sorts of machinery to cut a huge channel in between the two properties and even channeled water into it. A creek is now in between the two properties. The next morning, someone knocked on the older brother's door. It was a carpenter and said, "I'm looking for work. Would you have anything for me to do?" And the older brother said, "Yeah, actually, yes. You know, that property is my younger brother's property, and I don't want to see him any longer in my life. I would like you to build a huge fence of boards in between the two properties, because I don't want even to see their house. Can you do that for me, please? Oh yeah, he said, I can finish it by evening. Okay, start. That's the wood, the boards, and you start your work. And he started working. The owner went into the city doing shopping and all sorts of other business, and it was late evening when he came back. And when he came back, he was expecting to see a wonderful, wonderful and high, tall wall in between the two properties. And instead, his heart almost sank in that moment when he saw that the carpenter built a bridge over the creek, what the younger brother channeled there. And as soon as the older brother came home, the younger brother saw him and started running towards the bridge. And the younger brother said, "Brother, you are much better and much greater than I could ever be. Look at what you have done. I wanted to separate the two properties by this creek. And by your good heart, you built a bridge over the creek. Please forgive me." And the two embraced each other and made a decision that they would never ever separate. And they looked at the carpenter and said, "Sir, you stay, because we are going to give you work for months." The carpenter packed his tools into his box and said, no, sirs. I need to move on, because there are plenty of people who want to build walls, and I need to build bridges in between. Are you a wall builder or a bridge builder? God bless you. Amen.